Welcome, everybody, to those who are listening and are watching, to the Kingdom and its Stories. And we have the privilege of having Phoebe Johnson with us today. And we'll learn a little later from Phoebe who she is and hear some of the stories that she has to tell us that illustrate what this program is about. What is this program about? It's about interviewing people who have allowed Jesus to use their hands and feet to be his hands and feet in the arena of life in which they happen to find themselves. And it doesn't matter where we find ourselves, Jesus is always interested in using our hands and our feet to show himself to those he loves. And who, whether they are aware of it or not, are desperate to know him. So, Phoebe, welcome.
Thank you.
We're so good. Glad to have you with us this morning.
I'm excited to be here.
Thank you. Tell us the elevator speech of who you are so that those who are listening can get acquainted with you. Who are you? Who is Phoebe Johnson?
I would love to share. Thank you so much for inviting me to be a part of this. You know, I was waking up this morning and praying. I was like, God, please just give me your words. Like, who do you want me to share today? And so I was just thinking, you know, I just start from the beginning. You know, I'm a twin, so I have a twin brother, and I also have sisters who are twins. And we were all placed into foster care at a very young age. Mm. I was 2.5 years old when I first entered foster care. And I would say where that's kind of my story starts for sure. My biological mother was a drug addict, and my biological father took off and then landed himself in prison. And we were placed into an incredible foster home who loved us, who shared Jesus with us, and also became the safest place we ever knew. And it took about 12 years, a 12-year fight. We were kind of placed back with our biological mom, and then we were removed and placed back in the foster family and then removed again. And that went on for about 12 years until my biological mom had to go to prison for a very long time. And so the courts finally gave my foster family a legal guardianship. And growing up with all of that started to develop a lot of anger, a lot of confusion, a lot of heartbreak, feeling unworthy, didn't really understand this loving God that they kept talking about. How could there be this Jesus who loved me and wanted to walk with me, yet all these bad things were happening? There was a lot of trauma, a lot of abuse, and my brother couldn't handle it. By the time we got to high school, my brother had such anger and didn't know how to manage it and did not have the tools to help him out with it. And they ended up sending him to another family as well. So you can imagine I wake up one day and I have a mom, I have a brother, and I have sisters. And now, you know, 12 years later, I wake up and it's just me. My sisters were placed in another foster home. Mm. My brother was sent to another home. And I found myself very alone, very frightened. I didn't think anyone really cared. And so I started going down that dark path of, I think I should just end my life. I don't think I make a difference. I don't think anyone would even notice that I was gone. And the feelings of abandonment were so strong and so isolating. And high school is hard as it is, you know, you're growing up and you're developing and trying to figure out who you are. And I had all this baggage that I was bringing with me.
Wow.
And I definitely walked down the path of suicide. I had it all planned out. And I said, all right, God, if you're real, if you're really there, if you're really listening, you're going to have to show yourself. I don't believe what they're saying, but you're going to have to prove it to me.
Okay.
And I think we all know if you ask God to do something, 9 out of 10 times he's going to show up in a mighty, mighty way. Sometimes he might make you get there on your own. But he did. He started aligning things in the way that I needed to see. I got accepted into Grand Canyon University. My brother came home, kind of realized what was going on, apologized. He joined the military, which was really good for him. And I had a really good conversation with my foster family. I think there was a lot of fear of when I turned 18, what was going to happen? Because they never adopted me. It was just legal guardianship. And they reassured me that, hey, you're our daughter. We love you. We're not going to kick you out. You're a part of this family, and that's just what it's going to be. And so I started to say, okay, God, I think this is you. I think you're showing yourself to me. And so I sat down and I fully gave my heart to him and said, look, I'm going to give you my heart. I'm going to give you full control. And I'm going to read my Bible and I'm going to do all the things that they say I should do. I got really involved in my foster family's church. They were pastors. I got super involved in the youth group and I realized I kind of had a gifting for young people and I could really relate to them. And, when they say the grass was greener, the sky was bluer, it was really beautiful. And God has been with me since that. I mean, the whole time, but really since that moment, I've really got to walk hand in hand with him. I went into college, which was a scary time, but an exciting time. And my foster family walked with me through the whole time. They got me set up in my dorm. They stood in line with me to get all my books and my paperwork. And they really showed me the way. And I was so grateful. And that's really, I started to develop a relationship with my parents. I started to call them mom and
It took
dad.
all that time.
All that time. And unfortunately, my second year of college, my foster mom, my mom, had a heart attack and she passed away. And I was devastated. I had a really hard time with that because I got super angry with Jesus. I gave you my life. I gave you everything. And how could you take the one person that fought for me, that really showed me who you were, showed me who you are and the love that you have for me? She's gone. Just like that, she's gone. And I was ready to pull out of school. I was ready to go back down that dark path again. And I was introduced to a nonprofit organization here locally in Arizona that helped children and teens that experienced foster care. And they came in, they gave me a full ride scholarship the rest of my years at college. They gave me a mentor. They walked with me and really showed me, hey, God is still here. He's still opening doors. He's still holding your hand. And so I finished college. I got a job. I'm married. I have a little baby boy. And God has just been so fruitful in my life. So that's just a little bit about who I am.
I've been, Judy and I, my wife, have been foster parents. And we've also been, we are adopted parents, you know, with two different people and two different boys. And so, you know, one of the things that I picked up from what you said is the encouragement that your testimony is to those foster parents and adoptive
so
parents
many.
Who go through the trauma, and there is a lot of trauma,
yes,
you know, in involved in trying to love foster kids and the children that you've adopted. So thank you for your testimony. That's encouraging to me to listen to that. So Phoebe, what does that mean for right now? What are you doing with all of that?
God has been so good. You know, I was in the nonprofit sector for about 9 years. So on the front lines, working with the kids, working with group homes, foster families. And then I had my son, and it became really hard. I was feeling really guilty when I was with the foster kids. I was feeling guilty that I wasn't with my son. And then when I was with my son, I was feeling very guilty. And so I was asking God, where does this go? Where do we go?
Mm-hmm.
And Scottsdale Bible Church started an initiative for foster care.
Okay.
And at that time, they were looking for someone to kind of come in and help. And so they heard about me, invited me in for an interview. I heard the amazing things that they were doing and wanting to do. And I was like, yes, I'm on board. I am here. I knew God had like a next level for me, not just to work with the kids, but to be able to educate those and to really bring the church as a bridge, because the state doesn't make good parents. It really has to be the church that steps in. And I was all for this. So they offered me the position. And so I've almost 2 years now have been working for Scottsdale Bible as their foster care manager. And I kind of have three buckets that I work in. I have my foster families that I love. I have my foster care nonprofits and organizations. And then we also bought a group home underneath our ministry umbrella as well. So we get to love 8 little girls and about 15 staff.
Oh, do you have time for all that?
you know, God makes it and we prioritize and do what we can and show up and, you know, God does the rest.
Right. Wow. You have a full plate.
Yes.
But it
But I
sounds
love
like
it.
God has really prepared you, you know, for
Yes.
this strategic role. And I love to hear that you're with Scottsdale Bible Church. I have a very soft place in my heart. They've been so supportive of so many people.
Yes.
Like you and like me.
Yes.
So
Amen.
Anyway, tell us some stories, Phoebe. How has God used you tangibly in the lives of others to be his hands and feet?
Yeah, you know, I love sharing stories. I think the very first story I'm going to share is the very first time I ever shared my testimony. You know, growing up in foster care and coming from the background that I had, I didn't realize I had a testimony. I didn't even realize I had anything people would want to listen to. And that nonprofit organization that took me under and gave me a full ride scholarship and gave me a mentor, they invited me down to a summer camp. And they do this summer camp every year, and it's designed for kids in foster care, and they make it 100% free. And they said, hey, come down. You can come serve. You can be what we call a cousin, which is a camp counselor.
Yeah.
And then they asked me, would you share your story? And I was like, what do you mean? And they said, people would want to hear where you came from.
Yeah.
And I said, okay. And I was very unsure of myself, and I was still kind of a baby Christian. And so I just showed up. I really had no expectations, really had no idea what I was going to say. And they brought me into a room of 40 teenage girls. Talk about intimidating. And I just remember staring at them. And all of a sudden, words just started coming out of my mouth. And I was able to share where I came from and where God had brought me. And I think I did it in 10 minutes because I spoke so fast. And these girls started to cry. And I got to pray with them. And I got to show them, hey, we're all resilient. God has designed us with a plan, with a purpose. And I realized right in that moment that I had a gift and I was able to walk alongside these girls and encourage them and remind them, hey, if I can do it, so can you. And I'm going to hold your hand and Jesus is going to hold your hand. And I think that was the first time I realized, wow, I actually could be God's hands and feet and really use the testimony that he gave me to inspire other kids going through the exact same thing that I went through.
I think that's a great reminder of the fact that sometimes we feel so inadequate.
Yes.
And God just says, you have a story.
Amen.
Tell other people your story of your walk with me. And that's powerful, Phoebe. I love the fact that those girls were touched by your story. You didn't even know
right
that you had.
That's how good God is.
But yeah, and that's how good he has made us in spite of our weakness.
Yes,
I love that. Another story.
Yeah, you know, so in that group of girls that I was able to share my testimony with, one of those girls, her name was Kim, came up to me and I instantly felt this connection with her. And so through the years, I started to mentor her just like someone had mentored me. And I think that is one way that we really can give back to our community and to really show them what it's like being hand in hand with Christ. Because I feel like God disciples us every single day. He pushes us. He protects us. He says, hey, do this, do that. And so I really wanted to be able to give back. And so that was the very first way I felt like I could give back was mentoring. And so I would meet her, you know, once a month. We would go to breakfast and I kind of hear what's going on. And I quickly realized she was kind of in the same space that I was in high school. She was in a really deep depression, really feeling unworthy, not feeling good enough. And so I got the chance to go pick her up and take her to breakfast. And I sat down and I just had a really honest conversation with her and said, look, I get it. Life really sucks right now. You have been dealt a really, really bad hand in life. And I understand that. I have all the compassion for it. But if you sit in that, it's going to take over. And I really got the chance to sit there and push her and say, hey, at some point, you're going to have to forgive. At some point, you're going to have to let go so your past doesn't keep dictating your future.
Hmm.
And I helped her take steps in the right direction. For the first time ever, she was open to counseling. And I really believe that, you know, all of us that have trauma and all of us that have a really hard thing going on in life, you need a buddy, you need someone you can talk to. And I was really able to encourage her and push her towards seeing a counselor. And I helped her find a counselor. And I went with her on her first session, which is kind of unheard of. But then I got to sit there and listen to her share with her counselor how incredible it's been for her to have me as a mentor and kind of what it did for her in her life to encourage her and to keep her moving and to know that, you know, when she's having a bad day, she has someone to call. When she's having a good day and wants to celebrate, she has someone to call. And I just remember sitting there and again, just like, thank you, Jesus. Thank you for allowing me to be in this position to sit here and not only encourage her, but then get to listen and see her side of things, because that was so encouraging. And again, it just kept pushing me to mentor more teens. I really have a heart for the teens. A lot of times teenagers get kind of pushed in the corner. It can be intimidating. But teenagers, you can have a conversation with them. You really get to see the progress that they get to make. And you really have an honest conversation and an honest connection with them. And I absolutely love that. And so to this day, I'm still friends with Kim. She was at my wedding. She was part of my baby shower. I mean, all the things. And so now I get to see her mentor others. And so you really get to see this domino effect start happening, which I just think is so incredible.
Phoebe, thank you for sharing that story. We'll hear some more, but before we do, I want to just remind our listeners that you're listening to The Kingdom and Its Stories, or watching it. And in this podcast, what we try to do is encourage those who are listening to examine through the testimony and because of the testimony of those that we interview, how they might more creatively be Jesus' hands and feet in the place where God has put them.
Mm-hmm.
You don't have to be full-time.
Amen.
You don't have to be, you know, recognized as this person. You just need to be available. And God, if we are available, will show us how we can represent him in the lives of others. So, Phoebe, your position at Scottsdale Bible is what? What's it titled?
Foster Care Manager.
Okay. And you said that you have a home?
We do. That,
and you have... What are the other programs? Remind us again that,
yeah.
that
so we have
level has.
We have Gigi's Cottage, which is a group home that falls underneath Firm Foundation Youth Homes. And in that home, we have 9 girls we get to love. And then we have about 5 or 6 nonprofits here in Arizona that work within the foster care community that we love and we trust. And so either we're helping them financially, we're either sending them volunteers or helping with events. And so that's always fun and exciting. And then when I started at Scottsdale Bible Church, they had identified, you know, maybe 10 families, foster families within the church. And about 2 years later, we have now identified over 115 families. And so with that, I started a support group. We designed Parents Night Out. Hey, bring your kids, including your foster kids, drop them off. We'll take care of them. Here's a gift card. Go have a night out. Go have dinner. Go sleep. We don't care. Just go have 4 hours to yourself and then come back and get your kids. We want to make sure we're loving our foster families, making sure that they're able to continue to do what God has called them to do, because it's literally the hardest thing that they will ever do.
Oh, I love that.
Yeah.
The hardest thing they will ever do.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's not easy.
It's not.
But is it worth it?
100%. You know, I think even back to my story, you know, the government gave my foster family legal guardianship. And when I turned 18, that dissolved. And we had always talked about adoption, but we never got there because my foster mom passed away.
Right.
But then after college and after I got married and I had my son and I became the primary caregiver for my dad, my foster dad, I decided we should still do it. We should still move forward with the adoption. And so as a 29-year-old girl, I had to get permission from my husband. I officially got adopted by my foster dad.
Wow.
And it
Wow.
was the most rewarding thing ever. And let me tell you, my foster dad, when they took us in, was in his 50s. He thought he was too old to take care of us, that he was going to be a grandpa, and just didn't think it was going to work out. And he has been the best dad. He was already set in his career, so he came to all of our high school events, all the ball games. He was super involved, always drove us to school. And God can really use anyone. It doesn't matter your age, it doesn't matter where you're at in life, whether it's large, big, small. God can always use you. And God definitely used my foster family, because if it wasn't for them, I wouldn't be here. And I am so grateful.
That is amazing.
Yeah.
I love the story of you being
Yeah.
adopted at 29 years of age. That is absolutely amazing
It
and
was.
thrilling to
Yes.
me. So, wow. So, you don't have to be somebody special.
No, God calls all types of people, and you don't have to be qualified either, because God qualifies you. And the state and the church, at least Scottsdale Bible, offers a lot of help and a lot of resources. You're not going to do this alone.
Right.
Yeah.
So tell me one another story.
Okay. You know, I've obviously met a lot of people in my life, and I think the most exciting time is when I was able to mentor those teenagers and then encourage them to go to college. Now, college can be really scary for kids that are in foster care, because when you turn 18, you're almost expected to be an adult.
Okay.
And that can be really intimidating, to have a job, to figure out college, to figure out where you're going to live. Do you have transportation? And so I had one gentleman who really wanted to go to college for mechanics, more of a trade school. And so we sat down and we started researching, we started looking, and we found this program here at a local community college. And so I was able to actually take him down there, just like my foster family did for me. I stood in line, I helped him get his ID, I helped him fill out his FAFSA, you know, all the things that can be very scary. And I remember sitting there as we signed the document, we went to get his classes. He looked at me and he said, "Is this real?" And I was like, "Yeah, this is real. You're doing it." And he was like, "My biological mom told me I would be nothing, that she would be surprised if I even made it to 18." And I was able to give that young man a hug and said, "Well, you did it, and you're going to make it to 24, and you're going to make it on beyond that." And so he was able to go to college. And again, to this day, I'm still very much involved in his life. He was at my wedding as well, comes over. He's coming over to dinner on Thursday, and he's about to be 24 years old. And to sit there and look at someone who else used the resilience that God gave them to become something more than that was ever spoken over their life is just incredible. And a lot of my stories are along those stories of walking alongside people, getting to mentor, getting to encourage. Every day at work, I have foster families calling me, "Hey, I don't know what to do here." And it's like, "It's okay. We're here to help. I'm going to get you a resource. I'm going to get you some counseling." And join the support group. It's a lot about encouraging. It's a lot about saying you can do this. And so I absolutely love being able to be God's hands
Well,
and
not
feet
only
in
do
those
foster
ways.
kids need counseling, sometimes foster parents need
They do.
counseling.
It's complex. There's a lot of dynamics that come with it, and there's no shame in that. Everyone needs help. Everyone needs tools. That's what counseling is. It's tools in your toolbox to pull it out, to be like, "Oh, that's what I do when my kid is, you know, having a really hard time regulating himself."
Right. Phoebe, if you had a minute to just share with the listeners something about encouraging them to get involved in this kind of an activity, what would you say?
I would say, you know, do it in fear. It's okay to do something in fear. God will meet you where you are. It doesn't take anyone special to step into foster care. And that doesn't mean you have to be a foster parent, even though I really encourage you to be a foster parent. There's so many communities out here, organizations that you can volunteer. You can be a mentor, you can help at small events, you can help with Life360 events. There's so many ways. Just take that first step, and God will help you get it to the deep end.
Well, Phoebe, this has been fun.
Yay! Thank you so much.
Thank you so much for your willingness to come and share with us today. I think that it really helps the average person to hear from someone like you who's been through the life of being a foster child and then being on the other side and helping others consider being foster parents or contributing to the foster care ministry. Phoebe, God bless you, in your ministry, and may our conversation today be used by God to multiply what he's doing in this arena. God bless you, and thank you so much.
Thank you.